This Filmmaker IQ lesson is sponsored by ICANN, award-winning designer, manufacturer, and distributor of professional video, film, and broadcast production equipment. And by Blackmagic Design, creating the world's highest quality solutions for feature film, post-production, and television broadcast industries.
Welcome to FilmmakerIQ.com. I'm John Hess, and today we're going to look at the largely forgotten special effects technique of slit scan and try to recreate the Stargate sequence from 2001 A Space Odyssey using Legos. Imagine it's 1966. This director named Stanley Kubrick comes up to you and says, "I want you to create the Stargate sequence for my new film, 2001, A Space Odyssey, where Dr. David Bowman travels through time and space before landing in a cosmic zoo and ultimately being reborn as a star child." Well, Buck Rogers, this ain't. No film at that point treated space travel so seriously. Oh well, this shouldn't be too hard. We'll just open up After Effects, drop in a couple pieces of artwork, throw on the 3D camera, and animate it flying through this Stargate tunnel. Oh wait, it's the mid-60s, and the computers at the time were the size of living rooms and had less computational power than a modern calculator. Now, Kubrick was making a serious space film, and he didn't even have a full picture of Earth as seen from space. This famous one here, the blue marble, was the first photo of Earth of its kind, and it was snapped by Apollo 17 astronauts in 1972. So how was this Stargate effect created by the real-life 2001 visual effects supervisor Douglas Trumbull? Well, to find the roots of this technique, we need to go back to the mid-1800s and the origins of slit scan. The pioneers of photography in the 1800s were apt to try all sorts of experimental techniques, including a technique called slit scan. Slit scan is the process of putting a sliding slit between the subject and the photographic plane. The photographic medium under the slit would be exposed as a slit traveled from one side of the frame to the other. One of the earliest uses for slit scan was panorama photography. Originally developed by Joseph Puckberger in Austria in 1843, the Ellipsen daguerreotype was a swinging lens system that captured 150-degree views onto 19 to 24-inch long plates. Keep in mind, this is the era before flexible celluloid film. The following year, in 1844, Friedrich von Martens, a German living in Paris, made the megascope camera, a similar device using a swinging lens, but controlled by gears and handles. But slit scan really started to become popular when flexible film came into use, especially as a relatively inexpensive way of creating panoramic shots. By the turn of the century, cameras were being developed that ran the film along a curved imaging plane. The slit would then orbit around this curved image, creating the panorama. Now, slit scan had other uses as well. One really, really important one was at the racetracks. See, gambling on races had become very popular in the 1940s, and to avoid the air of corruption and tight finishes, racetracks needed a photograph of who came in first. Contrary to what movies or cartoons depict, these photo finishes weren't just some guy with a flashbulb at the finish line with a hair trigger. Instead, they used a variation of the slit scan technique called strip photography. Strip photography uses a stationary slit, and the film is moved underneath. This photo creates a record not of spatial relationships, but of temporal relationships, time. The slit doesn't move, only what's in front of it. So when you look at a photo, you're looking at the exact same spot, only recorded over a period of time. The slit scan concept and its digital derivatives continue to see use today in racetracks around the world. So how do we get from the panoramas and racetrack bedding to a technique that can be used for motion pictures? Well, in 1964, a short film titled To the Moon and Beyond premiered at the World's Fair in New York City. It was shot in Cinerama 360, which was a 70mm single film process using fisheye lenses, and projected onto a domed screen. In attendance was Stanley Kubrick, who was getting ready to shoot his grand space opus. Kubrick hired the special effects company behind To the Moon and Beyond to create some preliminary test shots for 2001. One of the special effects artists working at that company, a young Douglas Trumbull, cold called Stanley Kubrick and asked to work on his film. Kubrick accepted, and Trumbull spent 2.5 years working on the special effects for 2001 Space Odyssey. Now, for the Stargate sequence, Trumbull was inspired by the work of animator John Whitney, who also worked on To the Moon and Beyond. John Whitney was the animator that worked with Saul Bass on the spiral graphics for Alfred Hitchcock's 1958 film Vertigo, which happens to be the first film to use a computer for animation. That computer was a World War II anti-aircraft targeting computer, but still a computer. During the 60s, Whitney had been experimenting with leaving a camera shutter open for long durations while moving artwork around on motorized tables. Trumbull took Whitney's experiments and combined it with the slit scan concept. His approach was to put the slit outside of the camera. The camera was placed on a movable platform aimed at a 4-foot slit. Behind the slit was a wall of gel patterns on a moving table. When the shutter was released, the camera would dolly in toward the slit, while the gels behind the slit were moved from left to right. After each 60-second exposure, the graphics on the gel would be advanced just slightly, creating the animation of flying through a Stargate made of light. A fitting process which blends the relationship between time and space for a scene where Dr. David Bowman is doing the same thing. And this method for creating slit scan effects would continue to see use in special effects for the next 30 years, including the Doctor Who intro. Star Trek The Next Generation would also use slit scan techniques for when the Enterprise made the jump to warp speed. But once digital effects came into prominence, the painstaking slow slit scan technique fell by the wayside. After looking at Douglas Trumbull's schematic for his slit scan device, I decided that making a modern-day scaled-down model wasn't totally out of reach, although I may have underestimated how difficult it would be. Like most mad scientists slash filmmakers, I had a mechanized slider lying around. I built this a couple years ago by adding a timing belt and pulleys to a slider with the intent of being able to automate the movement, sort of like for a time lapse. On one end of the slider, I connected the end pulley to a unipole stepper motor, which is controlled by a USB controller and a laptop. Stepper motors are really good for this kind of application because they allow precise reproduction of movement. On the other end of the slider, I attached my Lego carriage gizmo with a large clamp. Built out of Lego Technic gears and bricks, which I've had since I was a kid, this gizmo draws power from the slider's timing belt, sends it through some bevel gears and a chain where it turns a worm gear. This worm gear slowly rotates a large gear on which the artwork carriage sits. The artwork itself is transparencies with various patterns printed on with an inkjet printer. In between the gizmo and the camera, I placed a piece of cardboard with a large slit cut out. Using gaffer's tape, I was able to get the size of the slit down to about 1/8 inch, or about 1mm. Now, creating the raw film for my Stargate is really a matter of creating a time lapse with long exposures. The stepper motor is controlled by my laptop, where I can tell the motor exactly what step to go to. So I designate 0 as my extreme close-up. I gave myself a little extra room on the close end, so I had some space to ramp up the speed. Usually I started off at step 700, and I realized the numbers are backwards just because that's how the system was set up. From 700, I would engage the motor to head to -7,000. Watching the motor count down on the computer, I remotely released the shutter roughly when the stepper motor hit 0. The camera would then shoot for a 20-second exposure, shooting at f/22 and ISO 160. The motor travels at 300 steps per second, so the shutter snaps shut right around step negative 6,000. The camera would continue to travel to negative 7,000 because it needs some room for deceleration. Now that's one exposure done. Then I would send the camera back to step 700 and set up for the next exposure. Once the camera is set and ready to go, I would advance the artwork carriage first by releasing the power chain on my gizmo and then spinning the worm gear 1/2 revolution before reattaching the power chain. Then it's the whole process over again for the next exposure. On and on it went. At maximum efficiency, I could do about 50 frames per hour. 20 seconds for the exposure, 20 seconds to reset, then 10 seconds to advance the carriage with a little left over for miscellaneous activity. Although the way I described the process seems straightforward, actually coming up with the setup was anything but. What works in theory always finds 1,000 complications in application. First off, Legos aren't exactly the most durable building materials. The first 3 out of the 5 redesigns for the gizmo were the result of dropping it and trying to recollect all the pieces after they had shattered all over the floor. On top of that, Lego gears have some give in them, which isn't great, especially when you're working on a small scale that the model is. But Legos are easy to assemble and experiment with, and that's what I had available. Now, trying to dial in the speed of the carriage was another difficult thing to accomplish. I tried manually moving the transparency or moving the carriage itself, but it wasn't until the final design when I used a worm gear that I could rotate to fine-tune the position that I get results that I found satisfactory. Now, for 2001, Trumbull's Slit Scan machine pulled focus throughout the move and did a slight pan left and right to fill the frame with the light streak, both of which I was unable to reproduce. His movements were 15 feet long, whereas my model ran only about 3 feet. His slit for his artwork was 4 feet high, and mine was a mere 6 inches. But unlike Trumbull's machine, which was fully automated, I had to babysit mine, making small adjustments for each exposure, again and again and again. But to my advantage, I do have HAL, or rather After Effects. Using After Effects, I could duplicate and stretch out my image sequences and apply nifty color effects and create my own Slit Scan Stargate. There's nothing quite as humbling as spending a 12-hour day creating 16 seconds of usable footage. Now, as much as I have a deep appreciation of how they did it back then, I've grown a much deeper appreciation of just what is possible today. Slit Scan has been replaced with digital processes that can accomplish so much more, and so much more easily. The filmmakers who came before us didn't have CGI, not because they thought that practicals or models or optical effects were better, because it just wasn't available to them. But these filmmakers still strove to make the best stories they could with what they had available. Some succeeded triumphantly, like Stanley Kubrick and Douglas Trumbull with 2001 Space Odyssey. But as history has forgotten, some have failed as well. I don't think the spirit of filmmaking, the need to tell stories, I don't think that has changed much over the years. It's just the tools that we have are so much better. The filmmakers before us created great works in spite of their technology. So, What's your excuse? Get out there, experiment, make something great. I'm John Hess. I'll see you at FilmmakerIQ.com.